It was a typical shack, just like the ones you hear about in Quebecois legends. Local lumberjacks used it to rest and twice a day heat up their pea soup. The leftover food, the clothes, the general warmth of the place, no evidence of escape. Carl was sure of it. People were here not long ago, and they expected to come back. Crossbow bolts had the same origin. Carl was sure of it. Who was it? And more importantly, what was being hunted like this? Without a single window to brighten things up, the inside of the cabin was almost pitch black. Beware of close encounters of knee and furniture. Solitaire. A card game only hermits can truly enjoy. Carl felt depressed at the thought of playing this. But a steak alone cannot subdue a starving stomach. An appetite comes with eating. This cabin doesn't look like a bunkhouse, especially with the missing stove and chimney. Carl was intrigued at the secrets possibly hidden here. A wintry atmosphere surrounded the house. The soundlessness of the area suggested it was empty. Little Martin Blais with his uncle Pierre. There was a deep sense of bonding and pride coming out of the picture. Carl felt sorry for the man. No one deserved such a cruel fate. The coals were still warm. Someone must have been stirring them up. Money in a jar. What a shame. Carl would have loved cookies. The key, which seemed to be meant for a padlock, bore an inscription reading Cloutier et Fils. A company name. Better keep an eye open. Businesses weren't exactly numerous around these parts. A pay stub for some undoubtedly harsh lumberjack work. Alexandre Blais felled trees and chopped woods for Cloutier et Fils. Window left open in that weather? Perhaps something had to be watched. The sheets were in such a way that indicated a rude awakening, followed by a hurried escape. What had happened here? Carl's big fingers prevented him from reaching the key. The track was fresh. That meant the car sunk down just a little while ago. Now where the hell could the passengers possibly have gone? Carl was becoming increasingly convinced that this was not normal hunting. The game that was being tracked was fearsome, so much so that the hunter didn't dare approach it. What could it be? There was only void where the road should be. Carl hated dead ends. He felt trapped. It was as if the road had drowned in the lake. He would have to find help by another road. Someone must have dropped this in a hurry, but whoever did was heading into the woods. Carl's tracking instincts were quickly kicking in. Prince? Carl found a surprise at every turn. Was the camera faulty, or was there a possible lead? Carl knew why he was suddenly shivering. He was going back to the realm of visions. Carl had no issue recognizing the spirit-like figures, but he couldn't figure out what they wanted from him. The phantom, freed of reality's shackles, vanished in the forest. Earlier, Carl had witnessed a tragedy that befell it. Another phantom disappeared in the wilderness. Carl had seen what happened to it too. A third phantom gently faded away. Carl noticed that as the cursed villagers finally left reality, he could feel a sense of unburdening exuding from them in an almost intimate way. The further Carl moved away from the ice block, the more his senses came back to him. It was so cold, already Carl did not feel his toes anymore. You had to be out of your mind to cook up white whiskey at home. The all-surrounding stench of alcohol alone was probably enough to gas a man to death. that it was mission accomplished with the wicked Nectar in his hands.